Hi everyone. Today we're going to talk about the properties of biological macromolecules. Now, there's four basic types of biological macromolecules that you need to know about for AP biology: nucleic acids, proteins, carbohydrates, and lipids. So let's start with nucleic acids. So nucleic acids are polymers or big long chains of nucleotides, and the order of those nucleotides stores the genetic information in the cell. All nucleotides, whether they're in DNA or RNA, have three components. They all have a 5-carbon sugar, they all have a nitrogenous base, and they all have a phosphate group. Now the 5-carbon sugar is different in DNA and RNA, and the nitrogenous bases are a little bit different as well. A, C, and G are found in both DNA and RNA. T is found only in DNA, and U is found in RNA. But the phosphate group is the same in both. Now, because DNA and RNA have different structures, they have different functions. DNA, as you all know, is a double helix. It's made of two strands, and those two strands are oriented in an anti-parallel direction. They face opposite directions. Now, RNA is usually single-stranded, however, so it has a different function than DNA. Now, some RNA molecules can fold back on themselves and form three-dimensional structures that are similar in function to enzymes and catalyze chemical reactions. And those RNA molecules that can do that are called ribozymes. And we'll talk about those more when we get to chapter 8, our chapter on enzymes. Next, let's talk about proteins. Proteins are big long polymers of amino acids, just like nucleic acids are big long polymers of nucleotides. Now, you don't need to know the names or structures of all 20 amino acids, but you do need to know the generic structure of an amino acid. All amino acids start with a carbon atom, and carbon, as we learned before, likes to form 4 bonds. One of those bonds in an amino acid is always attached to a nitrogen-containing amino group. Opposite that is a second bond that is attached to a carboxyl or carboxylic acid group. The third position is always attached to a hydrogen atom. And the fourth position is attached to what's called an R group or side chain. We'll talk more about those in a moment. Now, the order of amino acids makes up what we call the primary structure of a protein, and the primary structure of a protein determines its overall shape, and if we determine its shape, we determine its function. Now, amino acids have what we call directionality. If you have a protein or polypeptide chain, the first amino acid will always have its amino group showing at the start of the chain. At the end of the chain, you'll always have the carboxylic acid group. And if you wanted to extend this chain and make it longer and add more amino acids, you would have to add those amino acids to the carboxylic acid end over here. Now, if you look at this diagram, you'll notice those R groups or side chains are very different in different amino acids. Some of those R groups are hydrophobic, some are hydrophilic, and some even have plus or minus charges. We call those ionic. So the properties of those R groups determine the identity of the amino acid, but more importantly, determine how the amino acids are going to interact with each other in the protein and in its environment, and determine how that protein folds. And how that protein folds determines its structure, and that in turn determines its function. Let's move on to carbohydrates. Carbohydrates are made of big long chains of sugars. So sugars are the monomers or building blocks of carbohydrates. And the type of sugars and how they're linked together determine the structure and function of the carb. You might be surprised to find out that both cellulose and starch are polymers of glucose. Both have the same building block. The difference is how they are linked. They have different kinds of linkages, and that gives cellulose, also known as fiber, a very different function than starch, which is usually used more for energy, and it's all due to how they're linked together. Finally, let's talk about lipids. Now, lipids are nonpolar macromolecules, and there's two basic kinds of lipids. Saturated lipids have all single carbon-carbon bonds. this tends to make them have straight chains in three dimensions. And that tends to make them more rigid at room temperature because since they're straight, it's very easy to stack them on top of each other. Okay, so they tend to be more rigid. Unsaturated lipids, however, have one or more double bonds between two or more of the carbons. This causes a bend or kink in the chain, and that makes them more flexible at room temperature because they don't stack as well. Now, another kind of lipid, a very special category, is something called a phospholipid. We'll talk a lot about phospholipids when we talk about the cell membrane and how things cross the cell membrane. Phospholipids are what we call amphipathic. Amphipathic means they have a hydrophobic portion and a hydrophilic portion. I think of amphipathic, the root word amphi, you probably have heard it before in amphibians. Amphibians can live on water or land. Amphipathic molecules can interact with water, and they can also interact with nonpolar substances. Phospholipids are called phospholipids because they have a polar phosphate head. That's what you see here. And they have two nonpolar fatty acid tails. And those nonpolar fatty acid tails do not need to be identical. You'll notice in this diagram, in this particular phospholipid, one of those fatty acid tails is saturated, one of them is unsaturated. They can both be saturated, they can both be unsaturated. It varies, and the length of the fatty acid chains vary as well. When we talk about the cell membrane, we'll talk about how the cell can change the flexibility of the cell membrane by adjusting what? You guessed it, the proportion of saturated to unsaturated lipids in the phospholipids that make up the membrane. The more unsaturated lipids there are in the phospholipids, the more flexible that cell membrane is going to be. The more saturated lipids there are, the more rigid it's going to be. So let's review. So basically, the structure and function of macromolecules are determined by the building blocks they're made out of: amino acids, nucleotides, sugars, saturated or unsaturated fats, and how those are linked together. So I hope that makes sense. Have a great day, and I will see you guys next time.